So what would you do with 7 terabytes per second of memory bandwidth? Well, high performance computing, or HPC, with the latest hardware is today's focus. And I'm joined today by Mark Russinovich, a man who needs no introduction. Welcome back.
Happy to be back.
So 7 terabytes per second memory bandwidth is a tall order. So what makes something like this even possible?
Well, it is possible, and it's all in a CPU. Let me prove it to you. Here I have the Stream benchmark set up. And if you're not familiar with the Stream Triad benchmark, it's a benchmark focused on measuring memory bandwidth. And you can see that this virtual machine running in Azure is hitting almost 7 terabytes per second of memory bandwidth, like we said. Just to put that in perspective, this is an over 8x improvement generation over generation for VMs in our HB and HX series VMs using AMD's GenOX processors.
And it's really a lot of bandwidth. So where do you see this come in terms of being really useful and helpful?
I can think of a number of critical workloads where the primary bottleneck is the speed of memory. Think of scientific workloads. For example, if you're forecasting weather like the UK Met Office, or you're tracking dangerous storms that could be life-threatening and disruptive, those require the highest precision forecasts. And that's where you need high-performance compute that can enable precise computations at speed. And I can show you the difference between HBv4 and HBv5 in terms of memory speed. Let's look at another example with computational fluid dynamics, or CFD. We want to iterate faster with different simulations. Here, I have an ANSYS benchmark ready to simulate a wind tunnel test of airplane wings. On the left side, I've configured the HBv4 virtual machine, and on the right side, the HBv5 machine. I'll start the run on the left with our HBv4 system, and now I'll kick off the HBv5 one on the right. Each system takes 2 to 3 minutes to run, and there's nothing to look at while it completes, so I'll fast forward in time a little. Now I'll open up the logs, starting with HBv4 VM on the left, then the HBv5 VM on the right, so that we can compare each benchmark. If we focus in on the solver rows for each, you can see that the wall time per iteration of 0.911 seconds for the HBv4 and 0.345 seconds for the HBv5. The solver speed on the HBv5 is almost 2.6 times faster at almost 42 million cells per second per iteration. And the solver rating is also 2.6x higher. So yes, it's faster. And the real benefit is that you can perform more test iterations in the same amount of time on a single system. When memory bandwidth is the bottleneck, it doesn't matter what other resources you throw at it, including faster processors, more memory capacity, better disk speed or network speed. Those alone won't help the application until memory speeds improve. And that's why high bandwidth memory makes such a huge difference.
And I want to come back to this to unpack what makes this even possible for CPU and memory intensive workloads. But can you answer me one question? Why wouldn't I just use a GPU for something like this?
So GPUs and AI accelerators are great for certain kinds of workloads, like for AI training and inference, as well as various modeling and simulation applications, but it doesn't make sense to use them for everything. And they can actually introduce latency bottlenecks for specific HPC workloads. I have some code here to highlight a few inefficiencies when you're programming for GPUs today versus for CPUs, especially with memory management. On the left side of the screen is an example of code that runs on a CPU natively, and on the right, it's the same code but ported to a GPU. Now let's dive into the difference and I'll show you a few operations that would introduce latency. For example, in this operation with GPU code, you have to explicitly manage your memory by moving data to the GPU. So first, there's an extra step where we have to allocate memory not just on the host CPU, but on the GPU device as well. Then you have to copy the data from the host CPU memory to the GPU device memory. Obviously, you wouldn't need to do either of these on the CPU alone. Then this section is where the work is done and where everything's processed. It's more or less the same on both sides. And for each operation like this on the GPU, you'll then need to move the data back, like you're seeing in this line, to the host CPU. The code for the CPU on the left doesn't need any of these operations that can add latency and introduce more complexity. And it also gives the GPU code on the right more points of failure too.
And whether your workload is either CPU or GPU dependent, one thing that a lot of them have in common is that many HPC workloads, they don't need their systems running 24/7 by 365 days a year. And that's where cloud computing makes a lot of sense. So you're not locked into those expensive hardware purchases sometimes for 5+ years.
Right. And in the cloud and in Azure, you have a lot of choice. Computationally intensive workloads can have very different requirements. And in Azure, we want to make sure you have the right tool for the job. We have a wide variety of diverse platforms and offerings available to cater to your workloads. This way, you can make the right choice in terms of performance per dollar. Some HPC workloads, for example, still require 64-bit float as well as 32-bit float for double or single precision math, and those make more sense to run on a CPU for better cost performance. And on Azure, you're not limited to any instance type, whether you decide to use GPUs or CPUs. You can tailor your compute instance to meet your precise needs.
And speaking of which, this is actually including Microsoft's own silicon, in addition to new chip infrastructures that we've co-designed with a broader hardware ecosystem.
Right. And as we've talked about on past shows, our work here spans more than a decade to bring you the best choice. We're committed to silicon diversity, both with the work we're doing with our silicon partners and in our own house silicon development. For example, about a year ago, we announced that we're building Microsoft custom silicon with our in-house developed Cobalt CPUs, which are power-efficient ARM-based designs. We've made Cobalt 100-based virtual machines generally available, and we've already seen massive workloads running on them spanning Databricks, Siemens, and Snowflake. And you can also provision these VMs directly from the Azure portal, just like any other VM. They're already powering critical first-party workloads like Microsoft Teams media processing and a few of its Copilot capabilities. At the same time, we also announced our work on in-house developed AI accelerators with Maia 100. And these are already being used with Copilot service in addition to Azure OpenAI services for inference at scale. The goal with both these efforts is really to increase efficiency, optimizing performance per watt, and at the same time, pushing the boundaries for related areas when running data centers at hyperscale, like developing our own dedicated liquid cooling tower for Microsoft Silicon that comprises a rack-level, closed-loop liquid cooling system for more efficient heat transfer. In our in-house data centers, we've also optimized for high-bandwidth network connectivity as we connect arrays of multiple CPUs and GPUs for performance demands.
Yeah, and so given Microsoft's own silicon innovation here, then how are we influencing the broader hardware ecosystem to support different workloads that you see demand for?
I'll give you a few examples. When we started building out cloud-based supercomputers with thousands of connected CPUs and GPUs, not only was the network speed and reliability critical, but we also started to see memory capacity limitations causing bottlenecks. We've been working with our hardware partners for years with their silicon designs, and if we focus just on AMD, an example we started with, our collaboration on their MI300 series AI accelerators last year resulted in 192 gigabytes of high bandwidth memory. At the time, NVIDIA H100 series had just 80 gigabytes, so this was more than double that and still higher than the 2024 H100 refresh, which was upgraded to 144 gigabytes. And beyond AI workloads, for HPC workloads, together we enabled AMD EPYC server CPUs with 3D V-cache, super-fast cache vertically stacked over the CPU specifically for our HX series VMs. In fact, I recently spoke to AMD's CTO, Mark Papermaster. Here's what he had to say.
So we're actually a user of that technology here at AMD, and we're using the HX VM series to verify our next generation of chips. I'm really excited to say that we're seeing up to 60% speed up, and we're continuing our work together. The new specialized EPYC processor used in Azure's HBv5 VMs take this to a whole new level with a more than 8x increase in memory bandwidth to 7 terabytes per second. The HBv5 bandwidth increase enables new levels of performance for workloads with large data sets that far exceeds the capacity of the 3D V-cache.
And it's interesting that AMD themselves are actually using AMD-powered Azure HX series VMs to test their new CPU chip designs in HPC scenarios. In fact, Mark Papermaster mentioned the speedups with HBv5. So what makes this even possible?
Well, so for CPUs, memory bandwidth and memory capacity have always been tied. And now to support more demanding workloads, we've decoupled memory bandwidth from memory capacity on the CPU. Let me explain what difference this makes. For CPUs, traditionally, memory is provided with DIMMs connected via slots on the motherboard. Each slot has just one memory channel going to it, and it's connected to the CPU via copper traces on the board. We've now moved away from a separate component-based architecture to a unified system on a chip design, where high bandwidth memory can now coexist on the same package as the compute cores, which moves the memory closer to the CPU. In this case, we have 8 stacks of memory with 16 channels per stack, so there are a lot more memory channels to connect the HBM to the CPU. This means for HBv5, we have 128 memory channels per socket, compared to just 12 channels per socket in the HBv4. So by moving high bandwidth memory and the CPU to the same package, you gain more power efficiencies, and this is also how modern GPUs are designed.
Right, and before in your code demo, you actually demonstrated the challenge of having to port applications to achieve performance moving from a CPU basically to a GPU. So how much effort would it be then for customers maybe watching right now to go from, say, HBv4 to HBv5 and still take advantage of high bandwidth memory?
Yeah, we get that question a lot in terms of porting from one processor architecture to another, like from x86 to ARM, in order to capture all the promised performance. This was really important to us when we started working with AMD on the HBv5 platform to make it easy to move from HBv4 to HBv5 and get the performance benefits. Here I have the same side-by-side setup as before. On the left, I'm connected to an HBv4 VM, and on the right, I have an HBv5. First, I'm going to clone the benchmark that I showed in the beginning for measuring memory bandwidth. Now I can move into that directory and I'm going to compile it to run on this HBv4. That's going to take a moment to compile. I want to show that this benchmark will work without any modification on both generations of processors, and I'll prove that by checksumming the same file in both VMs. First, with it compiled, I'll go ahead and run it again on our HBv4 VM. It ran, and you'll notice this triad value is about 717 gigabytes per second versus around 6.7 terabytes per second we saw in HBv5. Now I'm going to run md5 sum stream to get a checksum of the binary we just compiled, just so that I can prove it's the same binary when we run it on HBv5. There's our checksum. Now I'll move over to the HBv5 VM on the right, and I'll SCP or copy the binary over from the HBv4 VM. I'll copy the path from the HBv4 into the HBv5, then bring the stream file over. Next, I'll also bring my scripts over. And from here, I'll run the md5 stream command again on HBv5 to prove it's the same binary. And with both checksums in view, you can see it is. Let's see if it runs. And as you can see, we get the full performance of HBv5 without having to do any porting or optimizing of the code, or even recompiling. So that means if you have apps that are starved for memory bandwidth, you can just run them on HBv5 and get that performance.
Right, so no additional work then if your code's already running on HBv4, but you get the massive memory performance gains when you move it to HBv5.
That's right, and this was all by design from the outset. Normally, when you make significant changes to silicon architecture resulting in that much performance improvement, that level of change isn't without consequence. And together with AMD, we've achieved this without impacting compatibility.
And this is really interesting insider perspective. So where do you see things going then in the HPC space?
So whether you realize it or not, HPC has a profound impact on the world. From safer cars and planes and buildings to cheaper energy to even studying the fluid dynamics of beer. You'll increasingly see AIML integrated into HPC applications to improve how we simulate the physical world. And as that happens, we'll see more merging of traditional HPC models with AIML techniques. And our goal is to continually guide that innovation so that we can help you achieve this without losing accuracy and maintain overall cost performance.
So thanks so much for joining us today, Mark. And if you want to learn more about high-performance computing on Azure, be sure to check out aka.ms/AzureHPC and also aka.ms/AzureHBv5 for more information about HBv5. Subscribe to Microsoft Mechanics if you haven't already, and thank you so much for watching.